Good evening, and welcome to Exploring Mars, hosted by the Commonwealth Club Silicon Valley and by WonderFest, the Bay Area Beacon of Science. My name is Tucker Hyatt, director of WonderFest. It is my pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers. Pascal Lee is a planetary scientist with both the Mars Institute and the SETI Institute. He serves as director of the NASA Haughton-Mars project at NASA Ames Research Center, and he co-founded the Mars Institute. Pascal is internationally recognized for his efforts to advance the human exploration of Mars. To that end, he has worked extensively in the Arctic and Antarctic to help plan missions. He is the recipient of the United States Antarctic Service Medal and author of over 100 scientific publications, of the movie documentary Passage to Mars, and of the award-winning science book Mission Mars. Andy Weir began working as a programmer at the age of 15. And later, he worked as a software engineer for several companies, including AOL, Palm, and Blizzard, collaborating on the creation of the Warcraft II video game. A self-declared, and I quote, lifelong space nerd, unquote, Andy began writing science fiction in his 20s. His novel, The Martian, was a New York Times bestseller and was developed into the Oscar-nominated movie starring Matt Damon. Andy continues to write, encouraged, no doubt, by receiving the 2016 John W. Campbell Award for Best New Writer. Moderating tonight's discussion is America's funniest and maybe our best science writer, Mary Roach. Mary is a member of the Mars Institute's advisory board, and she's ambassador for Mars One. She is the author of several best-selling books, including Stiff, Bonk, Spook, and Packing for Mars, The Curious Science of Life in the Void. Her book research for Packing for Mars included flying in the Vomit Comet for an immersive experience of real weightlessness. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Pascal Lee, Andy Weir, and Mary Roach.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. Hello. Is this on?
Sounds like it.
Yeah. Oh, there we go. Ooh. Now it's on. All right. Well, thank you all for coming. And we have quite a treat here. These are two very, very knowledgeable space guys, and I'm going to attempt to steer them to some stuff that will be very basic for them, but hopefully fascinating and exciting for all of you. I wanted to start out. I mean, there's been a lot of talk about missions to Mars these days. There's been, of course, recently Elon Musk announced his plan for the interplanetary transport system that's going to be shuttling. You know, we're going to colonize Mars and fairly rapidly by NASA standards. So I wanted to maybe you could just talk a little bit about that vision and kind of reality check it, you know, that would be, we'll start there, because that's sort of the big exciting thing. That was just, Elon Musk just presented his proposal, what, last week, right?
A week or two ago.
Yeah.
Well, shall I?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, well, I'm a big fan of SpaceX. I love the way they do things. I love their fail fast ideology, which sounds kind of weird, but it's what their plan is. Take larger risks so that we can reduce costs to the point that we, on average, get more done, which is fine as long as you don't have people on the ship. I think I being who I am, I double checked all the math on the plan for getting to Mars, and it all checks out. It's kind of inelegant. It's basically like we're going to take a really big rocket and put a ridiculous amount of fuel on it and go to Mars really fast, and then we're going to aerobrake at Mars and land this big old rocket on the surface. Some back of the napkin math shows me that they could have used considerably less fuel and put the ship in orbit instead. And then they could have used their, they're presuming they're going to have near perfect reusability technology. So I say, instead of, make your reusability technology such that your Mars ascent vehicles can refuel the craft in orbit, you know, bit by bit. So I'm not thrilled with that. Also, I think the budget estimates of the thing are wildly optimistic. He estimates that he can build the BFR, as it's called. It stands for Big Falcon Rocket. That's their story, and they're sticking to it. And the ITR, he's saying he can build a spacecraft for $200 million, a reusable long-range spacecraft. Now, the idea is that the space industry is not currently market balanced, and that more competition in it will drive prices down of all the components and make this feasible. But I would point out that the airline industry is market balanced, and a Boeing 777 costs $320 million. So I don't think you can make a long-range reusable spacecraft for less money than it costs to make a long-range reusable aircraft.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's my, and also the schedule estimates are pretty optimistic. They say they can launch a test flight in 2020, which is 4 years away. We've been waiting since 2014 for them to launch a Falcon Heavy. And at no point did they ever mention who's going to pay for it.
Yeah, a little bit of a challenge. Yeah.
Yes. good points. I tend to have mixed feelings about Elon's plan as well. There's a side of me that's completely on board. I want to see humans go to Mars. I think the time has come. I think Elon has really pushed the envelope of what we can do with rocketry. And really given humanity sort of a new prospect of seeing all this happen in our lifetime. So there's a lot of optimism and positive thinking that has me completely on board when I hear Elon's plan. But the other side of me that's more pragmatic is a side that realizes that really Mars is a very hostile place, and it's a very difficult place to get to. And when I heard Elon's presentation, I was expecting something a lot more sort of realistic from my perspective. In other words, bridging the gap between where we are now and how we're going to ramp up to eventually down the road get to what he's proposing to do. And so I tend to view what he presented more as a vision than as a plan. A plan would be something where, you know, what's the next step? Building the big rocket is not the only thing. That's what SpaceX will do. But I don't know if you followed the overall architecture, but the idea is to send 100 people at a time to Mars on this giant, super giant rocket.
And they would stay there as
they'd have the option to come back.
Oh, they'd have the option to come
back. They have the option, but it'd be frowned upon.
That was fun. I'm going home.
But
you have to have a note.
But the idea is to set up shop on Mars. Right. And so, like I said, I'm reminded of what something that Arthur C. Clarke said, which is every time you have a new idea, there are four stages to people's reaction to it. Stage number one is no, it's not possible, and it's not worth doing. And I don't want to be in that stage myself right now towards Elon's idea. Stage two is okay, it's possible, but it's still not worth doing. Okay. Stage three, as time goes by and things are happening, people's reaction become, oh yeah, it's possible. I always knew it. Okay. And stage four is, oh yeah, and that was my idea. So I don't want to say that what Elon's proposing is not real. I just want to say that I'm thirsty for details about how we're going to go from here to there. And there's a lot of details that need to be worked out.
One of the things that he was saying is that, you know, because you're going to have this much more powerful rocket engines, I mean, going a lot faster than has been previously achieved. It was like 19,000. I forget the exact. But anyway, it sounded like a lot of acceleration. Is that how's that going to?
He's not using a sort of a standard Holman transfer, which is sort of the most economical way to travel. He's essentially assuming there's plenty of fuel to sort of cut across the solar system in some sense, and
wildly,
get there in 80 days.
Yeah, it's wildly inefficient. The idea,
How many days did you say?
80 days.
80 days.
80 to 90.
Yeah.
It's not impossible. It's just, like you said, it's just not efficient.
As opposed to 500 or whatever. Yeah.
Well, 6 months. 254.
Yeah. As opposed to like a lot more.
Yeah. But I think they designed it from the ground up to minimize the amount of time that the passengers spend in space exposed to radiation, because they're not really doing anything to protect them from it. On a home and transfer, you spend considerably longer. But man, it takes a lot more fuel to do what they're doing.
Right. Well, he was talking about you would get the rocket up and the fuel, you'd feel it once you launched the thing, so at least you wouldn't have to launch all the fuel.
Well, you have to launch all the fuel.
But separately.
Yeah, but right. that just you still need to get all that mass up there. There's no cheating that system.
Right.
Physics is really good accounting.
Like little batches at a time.
Yeah. You still got to launch the little batches.
It's all right.
If you want to put all these rocks up on a shelf, you can put them up like five at a time or one at a time, but you're still putting all the rocks up on the shelf.
Yeah, so he's launching the... You leave the Earth with the outbound fuel, but you count on a fuel plant on Mars to refuel, and the fuel system that you're using in Elon's plan is methane and oxygen. And it's not an optimal choice for propellant, except that in the case of Mars, you can actually manufacture methane and oxygen out of existing resources on Mars. CO2 from the atmosphere plus H2O in the ground of Mars can then be converted by a process called the Sabatier process and turn that into methane and oxygen. And with that, you can fly back. With that, you have the rocket fuel that you need to fly back.
And that's extant technology, too. The Morpheus project, nothing to do with the Matrix. The Morpheus project at NASA showed that they could sustain and control a methane-oxygen propellant.
Yep. But you have to mature that system. People who are going there will rely on that fuel to have the option of coming back. The ship will need that fuel to come back. So you know, we have yet to produce methane and oxygen on another planetary body.
Ah, but in 2020, or the Mars 2020 probe will be having will have the MOXIE experiment, which does just that. It's gonna collect CO2, and I don't know, does it have the hydrogen built in, or does it collect it from the environment somehow?
It collects it from the environment.
Oh, nice. Yeah. And it'll do the Sabatier reaction. It's just a test to see if they can.
So, given all that you guys know, and you clearly know a lot, assuming we get sort of a global funding, you know, commercial and government and international, and everybody's behind it, and we have the money to do it, what's the timeline like?
So here's what was interesting, I thought. Elon presented this program at the International Astronautical Congress in Guadalajara in Mexico a few weeks ago. And that was a long-awaited presentation. And meanwhile, the schedule that he's presenting for the mission to Mars is really aggressive. I mean, we would be launching for the first attempt to go to Mars with that big rocket in 2024, bearing in mind that this mission that Andy just talked about to manufacture for the first time on a trial basis fuel from Martian resources is flying only in 2020. Okay, so I mean there's a lot of has to happen mm-hmm. there. But Elon's announcement, and then on the other side, the president's op-ed on CNN.com. Okay,
right.
So President Obama had one major space speech, which took place in 2010, early in his administration, and the schedule was given at the time, and NASA has been running on that schedule pretty much ever since. The schedule goes this way: we're going to go into deep space in the short term, and in fact, take advantage of the fact that we can access some near-Earth asteroids as a target for our early missions into deep space. And then by the mid-2030s, we have humans in Mars orbit, not on Mars itself yet, but in orbit around Mars. And I personally think that's a very good approach, because Mars orbit has Mars's two little moons that are very exciting to explore, and they're a whole story on there in themselves.
Just if I can interject, another awesome thing about Mars orbit is that, you know, during the days of Apollo, really the only way to get a good look at what's going on the surface of a planet was to have an astronaut on the surface. But now we have really, really good rovers that can do robots that can do all that for you. Unfortunately, Mars, the transmission time to Mars from Earth makes it really a pain in the ass to control those rovers. So what an astronaut at Mars provides you with is a human brain on site. So if you have astronauts in orbit around Mars, they could control rovers effectively in real time. And that's almost as good as having someone on the ground.
Yeah,
so maybe we can get back to that again, because there's some minuses to that too. But anyway, Mars orbit, and then humans on Mars, at the surface of Mars by the mid-2040s. Okay, so we're still on schedule when it comes to that. We need several elements in this NASA plan, because NASA's following this president-mandated plan. The giant rocket to get there, first flight in 2018 at this point, late 2018, so about 2 years from now. In fact, if you don't have something better to do in 2018, we should all go to the Cape together and watch the launch of the most powerful rocket ever launched. It's called the SLS, the Space Launch System. Hopefully by then it'll have a more attractive name. It should be spectacular. Okay, if it works, it will be spectacular. If it doesn't, it will be spectacular.
Even worse.
That's 2018. Now, in the mid-2020s, we're doing the asteroid thing, and there are different options that are being considered even now by NASA, but one of them is to get a piece of an asteroid by a little robotic probe, back to the Earth-Moon system, and then have astronauts visit that boulder.
Wait, is that particularly exciting for you, because your specialty is asteroids, right?
Well, it ought to be exciting, but I actually think that that's a distraction, that particular mission. I personally am not totally on board it. I mean, what we need to do is gain experience with deep space missions. That's one way to do it. But it's what I don't like about it is that it's relying on a robotic mission bringing back a boulder. So now you don't actually explore the asteroid itself, you just explore a sample from it. And, you know, to some extent, meteorites that we have in our museums are precisely pieces of asteroids already. So we could just launch a meteorite instead of going to get it. but joke aside, I see the benefit as being relatively limited. Now, on the other hand, I personally would be, and I think there would actually be public interest in this. I think that if we clearly make Mars in everybody's mind the destination of our new space program, then having milestones towards it to keep the public interested and just to have relatable milestones along the way, we don't need to make those milestones necessarily tied to a body. I mean, we've been to the moon, we've walked at the surface of the moon. How about the next milestone in going in towards Mars be, let's get humans to 1 million miles from Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the million kilometer mission, okay, and then we can do the 10 million kilometer mission. And those would be super exciting because they would actually test what we really need to be testing, the reliability of systems in deep space. So anyway, going back to the schedule, mid-2040s for humans on Mars, that's the NASA plan. And I personally feel that's more realistic given all the homework that needs to be done. And what was interesting about President Obama's recent op-ed is that it was made clear that it wasn't for NASA or even the United States alone to go to Mars alone, but that he saw a public-private partnership in that. And I think he was thinking NASA working with SpaceX.
Right, yeah. Right.
Well, and other companies.
Yeah, there are lots of, SpaceX is the most well-known private spaceflight, but Boeing has their stuff going on,
and
Bigelow.
Blue Origin. No, that's what
Okay, so Blue Origin's cool because they're working on technology that is Any advance in rocketry and space technology is good, but I think they're really pushing the definition of we're putting you in space. I mean, there's a huge difference between going up past the von Karman line and actually going into orbit. It's not that hard to get up into space. What's hard is to stay there. Mm-hmm. It's you have to get going 7,800 meters per second. Yeah. And just going straight up and then falling back down, it's not hard. That's the reason Blue Origin rockets are so small, because it just doesn't take that much fuel, and it's not a, not nearly as big a challenge. So while I think it's interesting that Bezos is going for a different approach, he's going for what can we do that has commercial applicability right now? And what it is if you go on one of those Blue Origin rockets, you get 4 solid minutes of zero G. Right. While you're coming back down.
Whatever happened to Virgin Galactic? Wasn't that the same word they
So Virgin Galactic, don't get me started. No. Virgin Galactic is basically you fly in a plane really, really high.
Yeah.
Now, here's a little tip. If you can still do aerodynamic flight, you're not in space. Okay, and so the flight ceiling for Virgin Galactic is like 80,000 feet, or it's really high. You go really high, but that's lower than the cruising altitude of an SR-71.
Okay, so it's like a really, really, really expensive simulated zero-G flight where they go like
that. I don't know if you get too much zero-G. You just go really, really high. What you can do, though, is you are high enough that you can see the horizon, the curvature of Earth, and it'd be a really cool experience. But I am a stickler. I say you're not in space unless you're actually in space.
I wonder if we could talk a little bit about the risks of long-term existence on Mars, particularly radiation. That's the thing that comes up over and over again: cosmic radiation, solar radiation. How do you, if you shield the craft, that's something heavy you need to launch. So how, what's the best approach, and particularly for a colony on Mars long term?
If everything is going well on a mission to Mars, the biggest danger that lurks during transit to Mars and back is space radiation. And that's assuming other life support systems are covered, like you have air to breathe.
Well, mainly it's because of the superpowers that the crew ends up getting and how they abuse those powers.
Okay. Space radiation, yeah, sure. So space radiation comes, here's what I like about the space radiation issue.
Okay? Superpowers.
You have space radiation from really two sources. You've got the sort of run-of-the-mill background space radiation that you're getting from the rest of the galaxy, from stars, black holes, pulsars. Okay, they are shedding cosmic ray, galactic cosmic rays. Okay, so that's one form of radiation. That's very hard to shield against, but the good news about that is that there are very few hits over time. They're sort of few and far between. The other form of radiation is solar radiation, and specifically radiation that comes in the form of charged particles that are emitted from the sun during solar eruptions, coronal mass ejections. Okay, so big, nasty storms on the sun will send out a wave of high-energy particles. Those are really nasty. Now, the good news about those is that you can shield yourself against them. And one of the most efficient way to shield yourself against that form of radiation, in fact, the galactic cosmic rays as well, is to have hydrogen between you and the incoming radiation. Okay, so this is why if you're going on a trip to Mars, you should line the walls of your spacecraft, of the habitat in which you live, with things that contain hydrogen. And ideally, that's food and water. Water contains hydrogen, it's H2O. Food has plenty of hydrogen, carbohydrates. Okay, so you're surrounded by food and water. Now the good news with that, is the water. Okay, so you drink the water, and then you have to go to the bathroom. It turns into urine. Urine, however, is recyclable. And so you're not going to take for, say, a crew of 7 people going on a trip to Mars, and a round trip time is 1 year, just to travel to there and back. You're not going to take a year's worth of fresh water for a crew of seven. That's way too much water. So you would take only so much water, and then you will plan on recycling it into your mission. So a few weeks into your mission, you're already drinking each other's recycled urine and sweat. Okay? We don't do this. We already do this on the space station, by the way, and it's working fine. So that's the good news. The bad news is with the food. Okay? The food, you eat the food, you go to the bathroom, but you cannot recycle poop. Okay? NASA is not even trying. If you write a proposal to NASA saying, hey, I have a solution to recycling food, you're not going to get funded, because a lot of work has gone into this, and we know that it's super difficult. Okay. So what are you going to do with the poop? You can't just open a window and throw it out into space. That's not good. First of all, no window opens. Second, you don't want to pollute space, but that's not even the reason. The reason you don't want to do this is because your poop still contains hydrogen. And that is radiation shielding for you. So in an environment like deep space, where resources are so sparse, you have to look at your own solid waste as a resource. You will never go to the bathroom with the same disposition ever again. When you flush, you're being extremely wasteful, okay? So what do you do with that?
So each of you needs to get a bucket.
Yeah.
Well, specifically, what you want is a Ziploc bag. Emphasis on lock. And the bag goes back on the wall where you took the food in the first place to patch the radiation hole, okay? So I recommend very thorough labeling.
Just a little more fun science on, fun as defined by me, science on radiation. So GCRs, galactic cosmic rays, which are very badly named because they're not cosmic rays, they're particles that are charged particles coming in. They come from all directions because they're created by stars all over the galaxy. And as Pascal said, solar radiation comes out, you know, from the sun. It emanates from the sun. Now, what's interesting about that is there's a solar cycle. Every 11 years, the sun goes through peaks and troughs of how active it is. And when the sun is extremely active, it's spewing out a whole bunch of this solar radiation. But its magnetic field diverts away a lot of the cosmic radiation. Uh-huh. So it's like you will either have a bunch of cosmic radiation or a bunch of solar radiation, but not both. So it is helpful that it kind of self-regulates. Another thing worth noting is that NASA is a super cautious organization. They don't like to take a lot of risks, especially when it comes to human life. But they recently quietly decided that the radiation you get on a trip to Mars is okay.
They just so
and that just went by.
That's true, but here's the data. On its way to Mars, Curiosity actually carried finally a radiation detector. It was an instrument called the RAD, aptly named, but it was radiation assessment detector. Okay, so it measured radiation on its between the Earth and Mars on the way there, and then. Now that it's on Mars, it's the rover, the big rover, Curiosity, it is also measuring radiation at the surface of Mars. So here's the upshot of the measurement, okay? On your way to Mars, you cumulatively will receive something that's of the order of 300 millisieverts. What that represents is, so that's during a 6 months outbound trip to Mars, okay? 300 millisieverts, that's about 24 abdominal CAT scans, okay? So over the course of 6 months, that's as if you were having a full abdominal CAT scan every week for 6 months, that's 24 CAT scans. Now, CAT scans, I should emphasize, are not dangerous. If you need one, you should go for it, okay? But 24 is kind of high, you know? It's not something you'd do if you don't need it. But it's still something that you would survive. It's something that's unlikely to really make you sick, and that's on an outbound trip to Mars. And then you'd have the same dose coming back. All in all, the radiation you would receive during your trip to Mars and back, and we'll talk about the stay on Mars in a second, would amount to about 30 CAT scans over the course of an entire year. So one CAT scan per week
That's a lot of CAT scans.
That's a lot of CAT scans. In fact, what it turns out to be is 30 times more than what OSHA accepts as being the maximum limit for any person working in a nuclear power plant per year. All right, 30 times more. But OSHA is very conservative.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's not benign, but it's not something that's a showstopper either. And it's something that, with proper water and poop management, you can protect yourself.
Poopology, as it's called. I'd like to talk about on Mars.
Yeah, go ahead. Okay, let's talk about on Mars.
So on Mars itself, you're actually way better off. You are.
Say that again. Armoires.
Armoires.
Okay, yeah.
That's what we're talking about. Uh-huh. You have an armoire. That's where the lion and the witch. Okay. On Mars itself.
Oh, on Mars.
Yeah. Okay. You're much safer because Mars blocks. I mean. Broadly speaking, Mars is blocking half the radiation that's coming at you because there's a whole bunch of Mars between you and it.
Super, super, super thick shielding.
It's very thick shielding. It's many thousands of kilometers of shielding. That's fine. And if you're going to do long-term habitation on Mars, you would cover it with dirt. You just have, like, so you could take Mars soil, which now we know has a buttload of water in it, and so it would actually be very good radiation shielding. So you could effectively have Earth levels of radiation for as long as you're on Mars with minimal effort. When you consider the complexity of colonizing Mars, putting a bunch of dirt on a roof is not that hard.
Yeah, that's a really good point. A lot of people talk about finding a cave on Mars where we should become, you know, troglodytes living in caves. There's a romantic appeal to the idea, but it's really unnecessary. All we need to do is a sandbagging machine, and those exist. If you live in a floodplain, you can, you know, call in the communal sandbagging machine, and it will put sand in bags for you.
Oh, that's why they call it that.
For levees. Okay. So anyway, it's one of those things where radiation shielding is one of the resources very, very readily available at the surface of Mars.
I've got a good question here. Once we actually get to Mars, what science are you most looking forward to?
Dr. Lee.
Well, the search for life. So here's the thing, okay? The reason why scientifically Mars is so interesting is because we now know that throughout its history, there's been water, liquid water, near the surface of Mars. And there are arguments about how much, so we don't have to take sides in this discussion, but the point is there's clear evidence that there's been liquid water around the surface zone of Mars throughout its history. Now, that's really interesting because on Earth, all forms of life require liquid water. And everywhere on Earth where there is liquid water that's clean, there's life in it. Okay, so there's a one-to-one connection between liquid water and life on Earth. And so NASA's strategy for looking for life has been to follow the water, to go to Mars, not to look for life directly because we're not quite sure what we might look for yet, but to look for water, which is believed to be sort of a universal solvent and something that any form of life that's carbon-based will like to be around. So from my perspective, the search for life is going to be the commanding scientific goal. And it's not just a search for past life. And of course, now we're talking about looking for microfossils in the ancient rocks of Mars. So that's one possibility. But the real exciting possibility, from my perspective, is the search for extant life, life that is still alive today, that's Martian life. And let me add the key point about the search for life, which is the fact that it's not just about finding life. It's about finding alien life. And something that we would be able to determine is really different from Earth life. Something that we could establish scientifically is alien life. All life on Earth, okay, you, me, you guys, my dogs, who had a prior commitment, could not make it, sorry. All life on Earth, okay, uses DNA and the same acid bases to form the DNA molecule. All life on Earth uses the same 21 left-handed amino acids to manufacture proteins. Meanwhile, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of possible amino acids that are chemically viable. but would not work for Earth life. So anyway, all Earth life uses the same specific recipe of chemicals. And the idea here is to, and of course, presumably, we all therefore come from a common ancestor. It was presumably a microbe of which we have no more record, even in a fossil form. So the idea in our search for life on Mars is to find a form of microbe on which we could do genetic analysis. And from that, we'd be able to determine whether or not it's related to life on Earth. If it were related to life on Earth, that won't tell you much, because Earth and Mars are not separate planets. We have meteorites that have come from Mars naturally to the Earth. We have about actually 100 meteorites on Earth that we know 100% for sure have come from Mars.
Okay, I have one at my house.
Okay, great.
So I really do.
Where'd you get that?
I bought it. It's legal, what? It's,
yeah, I have one in my briefcase too, but anyway.
But it was a street vendor, he assured me.
They by the way, they go for about $50 to $100 a gram these days, okay, and FYI. But you can buy meteorites from Mars, okay, or bits and pieces of them. But the thing about this is this, we're not isolated planets. Life could have started on Earth and been ejected by, because what happens is that an asteroid or comet hits Mars or the Earth and then ejects a piece of the planet to the other one. Okay, so you can imagine life having started on Earth and having been naturally thrown out to Mars, and therefore what we're finding on Mars is just Earth life. Or Earth life, or Mars life, somehow came to seed the Earth. And by the way, we're all descendants of Martians. And the reason why we want to go to Mars is just because we want to go home. Okay, so. But the thing about this is that if we were able to find an alien form of life, something that does not map onto the tree of life on Earth, something that's really different, that would be a major, major discovery.
Yeah, and the second genesis is what they would call it, a second genesis.
Yes, and I work at the SETI Institute here at in Mountain View, and the SETI Institute is interested in the search for life in all its possible forms and sort of manifestations in the cosmos. And we're really excited about this possibility, and there are scientists working on this, of finding extant life on Mars today. How would you determine genetically that it's different from us? You couldn't do just gene sequencing, because gene sequencing that we do for our own DNA to recognize whether we're related, I'm definitely not related to Andy, but to determine whether we're related is really specific to Earth's DNA. So we'd have to come up with some sort of a universal, you know, sort of universal gene sequencing apparatus. Okay.
Pascal, I wanted to, just following up on that, we were talking earlier about, you mentioned this amazing fact that on Earth, so 85% of the biomass is beneath the surface.
Yeah.
So, you know, to be able to be actually, you know, to have humans there that could actually, you know, take samples from below the surface. I mean, that's kind of exciting.
Where would we go from to look for this extant life, really? That's on the ground.
So but really, really, really deep.
Like, well, then you get a robot with a really, really deep drill. So my opinion is different than that of my far more educated colleague. seriously, I mean, I'm just a writer. But hate to be so pessimistic, but I don't think there's any life on Mars, nor has there ever been. And the reason I believe that is because if you go to Earth, let's say you were an alien coming to Earth to find out if there's life on Earth, you could take this much volume of Earth from literally anywhere on the planet, like from the air, from the ocean, from the ground, from Antarctica, from the tropics, anywhere. And it would be not just evidence of life, but utterly riddled with life. It's completely dominant everywhere. And so I have to believe, I have this kind of, and this is just instinct, but I've got to believe that once life evolves somewhere, it is extremely good at expanding and evolving to manage and handle every environment and terrain on the planet. And since Mars's transition from an ocean world to the kind of crappy desert it is today was very slow, it happened over many millions of years, that's a slow enough process that life could have evolved to deal with that as well. So I believe that if there had ever been life on Mars, it would be all over the place. And it might only be microbial, but there would still be some blatant evidence. Now, obviously, that's a very debatable opinion, but that's
hey,
that's
such
my
a
opinion.
Doggy
yeah,
downer.
No, it's,
I'm sorry.
It's super debatable, and here's why. First of all, Andy mentioned oceans. So I alluded earlier to this notion that there's some disagreement as to how much water there's been in the past. So some people think that there were indeed liquid water oceans on early Mars, but the evidence is really not clear. And I, for one, based on our work, we can have a huge tangent on that, you know, some other day. Don't believe that actually there were ever liquid water oceans. It's sort of a very geocentric vision of what early Mars was like, okay? But there's some reason as to why people have thought that. But regardless, the key thing about Mars in relation to life, Earth-like life, is that Mars represents an extreme environment, okay, for Earth-like life. And Andy mentioned correctly that if you go to most places on Earth, you will find life almost everywhere, except where you start going to places where the environment becomes so extreme that life starts to recede into tiny little recesses to protect itself, because now it's really at the edge and at the limit of life. If you go to, for example, very high altitude locations on Earth, or if you go to the Arctic, the polar regions, you will still find traces of life everywhere, but much less than in places, you know, in your home or my home at least. So the point here is that if you actually spend time in working in extreme environments, like I've been working in the Arctic for about 20 years, you realize that life is no longer visible at the surface of the terrain. It's hiding in the form of cyanobacteria, microbes inside rocks. It's sort of recoils into mini shelters that it can find when it's faced with an extreme environment. So the surface of Mars today, based on what we can tell from all these rovers we've sent, seems to be sterile. It's sterile because of ultraviolet radiation from the sun, because of cosmic rays. But there's no telling as to what might be possible deeper down. And as Mary brought up earlier, you know, 85% of Earth's biomass is underneath the surface of the Earth. If all life on Earth were wiped out at the surface of the Earth, rest assured we're still okay, because 85% of the mass that's living on Earth is still going to be okay.
We're actually not okay in that scenario.
Yeah, exactly.
Just
so to first order, it's actually quite possible for life to be eking a living inside Mars, deeper down, where there's liquid water, where it's warmer, where it's microbial, and meanwhile have not much to show for at the very surface where things are baked out.
We've got some really fun questions here, so we do like the lightning round here.
Lightning round.
Lightning round. Okay.
Lightning round.
What are your thoughts on the current milestone with ESA, European Space Agency's Schiaparelli lander?
Well, it failed to land.
It failed to land.
So
yeah.
That sucks.
A moment
I'm sad.
Of silence for Schiaparelli.
No, it failed to land softly.
Yes. I believe its final landing altitude was -3 meters or so. No, I don't know. They lost track of it. They don't know what became of it, and yeah. That's really too bad. I mean, I'm pretty bummed.
Yeah, last I heard, the contact was lost at touchdown, soft touchdown, -1 minute, which was the time when the parachutes would have deployed, would have been jettisoned. The heat shield would have been dropped off already, but when the parachutes were jettisoned, what had to happen next were the retro rockets had to fire up, and there was sort of a few seconds of free fall, and then the retro rockets would fire up. And what might have happened, and of course I'm speculating completely here since we still don't know, is the parachutes might have jettisoned, and then the thing could have tumbled. And if the retro rockets don't fire up in the right attitude, or if not all retro rockets come on, then all of a sudden you basically are not controlling your speed. And
do we know if Global Surveyor or any of the others are going to look for wreckage?
I think first of all we're going to learn more tonight. After this meeting, you can go home, watch the debate.
And then at 1 a.m. there's a press conference.
Or you could just go set a dumpster on fire and watch that instead.
Which brings us to our
next
question.
Conference at 1 a.m., yeah.
What have the current presidential candidates said about going to Mars or about NASA in general?
Well, Trump's going to build a wall around Mars. And Hillary and Clinton, I think, invented Mars. I don't know. I don't think either of them have a particularly clear space policy.
They've said a few things, yeah.
It's not clear. Actually, the most indication of a space policy by either party came from Obama. You know, and if you say that his opinions are like the Democrat Party position, then that's some information, but we don't
know much. The Clinton camp has apparently stated, in fact, Hillary Clinton has stated that she was in favor of humans going to Mars and wanted to enable it. It doesn't mean that we're going for it, but that we're going to take steps towards making it happen. The Trump camp, last I checked, eventually said they were in favor of space, but nothing specific about Mars.
It's sort of related. Building a stable society is something we have yet to figure out. How are the first 100 people, I'm assuming this is people, intended to get along?
Well, I would disagree with the premise of that question. I mean, I know things are depressing right now with our election and stuff, but we actually are an extremely successful and stable society, and the fact that this election is not a civil war kind of proves that.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Seriously. And so it's like, oh, woe is me. I don't like the two candidates that my completely fair and free democratic system has provided me. Shut up. So, cultures all over the world have figured out how to make solid functional societies. So I'm sure that if you took like 100 Chinese people and put them on Mars, they have a very functional society that's similar to modern day China. Take 100 people from, you know, Nigeria, you'll get a very functional society that's similar to Nigeria. And humans are very good at this.
Assuming humans can and will get to Mars, would this be a step to something else like the moon was to Mars? And what would that be, presumably?
Yeah, so let me comment on this a second. First of all, you have to understand why we went to the moon. We never went to the moon as a stepping stone to Mars, even though the people who made the Apollo program mission, like von Braun and a few others, had Mars in their sights sort of as a long-term goal. The reason we went to the moon was the same reason why James Cook was sent to explore the South Pacific or why Lewis and Clark were sent to explore the American West. It was to serve the national interest of their nations at the time. Okay, so James Cook went to the South Pacific not because the British Navy was interested in botany, but because the French were roaming the waters of the South Pacific. Lewis and Clark were sent out west not because President Jefferson was interested in wildlife, he was, but it was because it was in the national interest of the United States to know who was living out there. How could we trade with them? How could we communicate? How could we travel? Similarly, President Kennedy did not send Americans to the moon in the mid-60s because we were interested in moon rocks, or as a stepping stone to Mars. It was because the Soviet Union and communism were a threat. They were ahead of us in the space program. And the goal of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely before the end of the decade was something that was far enough in the future, difficult enough to achieve, that the United States had a chance to beat the Soviet Union at that. So, it was to serve national interest. So I don't think that the moon may turn out to be helpful to go to Mars, but it's not the reason why we went there. And similarly, going to Mars is not going to be, if we ever go, it's not to have it as a stepping stone to somewhere else. It will be because it will serve the national interest of the nations who are committing to go.
All right. I'm going to poll. This is a request to poll the audience and you guys. How many of you would like to go to Mars?
Just raise your hands.
All right. that what would have that?
You saw lots of hands.
No, I didn't see either one of you.
No, he clapped.
Oh, you did. Oh, yeah. All right.
But no, I would not go.
Yeah. He didn't even want to take a flight to the East Coast.
No, I don't. I mean, I write about brave people. I'm not one of them. I like Diet Coke and the internet. I mean, I don't want to leave.
I spoke to some kids in an elementary school not too long ago, and I asked the same question. Hey, who here would be interested in going to Mars? And I saw lots of hands. And then one hand stayed up, and the question was, is there Wi-Fi on Mars?
I guess you could have a local, you could have an intranet.
If not radiation, what do you think is the biggest risk to human health that we should address before sending anyone to Mars?
Well, starvation, I think. Need to have, you need to generate food there.
I mean, yeah. you need to generate an atmosphere. You need to. So here's the thing. You make a good point. Food is important, of course, but
this presumes the pressure vessels work.
Here are five ways that you will die on Mars. Okay. In chronological order of cause of death. So needless to say, only the first cause matters because the others are sort of academic. But let's say you walk outside on Mars without a spacesuit, without any protection, you're just exposed to the surface of Mars. The first thing that will kill you is the low atmospheric pressure. Because the atmospheric, in other words, the air is not thick enough on Mars to prevent you from essentially exploding. All right? You have, as we speak, oxygen and nitrogen dissolved in your blood. You've breathed those in a few moments ago. They are not in the form of gas once they're in your blood. They are sort of molecules in your bloodstream. Now, if the atmospheric pressure were to be lowered to the point where it's like it is on Mars, which on Earth you find only at an altitude of 125,000 feet, okay, 36 kilometers, you would experience violent decompression. So all these gases, the nitrogen, the oxygen in your blood, would bubble up. You would essentially fizz to death on Mars. Okay, so be like popping a can of shaken Coke, and it's a cruel and unusual way of dying.
But quick.
Okay. But if that doesn't kill you, then the next thing that kills you is the lack of breathable air. The atmosphere is made of CO2. If that doesn't kill you, it's the temperature. The temperature is very cold, on average minus 80 degrees Fahrenheit, okay, minus 60 degrees C. If that doesn't kill you, then the dust. The dust is very toxic. Okay, it contains perchlorates, peroxides. Imagine hydrogen peroxide in solid state. Okay, you ingest that. That's going to burn. The dust will tear up the tissues of your lungs. Will irritate your lungs. The perchlorates will grab your thyroid and destroy it. So you within weeks now you're dying of the dust. And then finally, if that hasn't killed you, then the radiation at the surface of Mars will kill you over time without any protection. But you can see that that's only the fifth cause of death, radiation. Okay.
Well then.
Who still wants to go to Mars?
But presumably there will be suits. Do you have anything to say about suits?
They might address some of those problems before going to Mars.
Yeah.
Like they might send a pressure vessel.
Yeah. There'd be a habitat, you know. That kind of thing. With the advancement of technology and automation and artificial intelligence, what is our true purpose on a new planet? We find new space, but for what purpose? Like, I guess, what's the point?
My opinion on that is as a backup for the human race and whatever else we bring with us to Mars, because it's not like we just send a bunch of humans and nothing else. Every form of life we send to Mars is now backed up. Well, it is unlikely there would be an extinction level event on Earth. The odds are not zero. We could get hit by a meteor. We could have a big old nuclear war. Mm-hmm. We could have some plague that wipes out humanity. But if we're on two different planets, the odds of our extinction drop to nearly zero. So that's what I like about. I forget which author it was. I always forget. I never remember to look it up. But I think it was Arthur Clarke. But he said, Earth is too delicate a basket to put all of humanity's eggs in.
Yeah. first of all, part of me feels a kinship with anybody who wants to go to Mars for whatever reason. So I will resonate a bit like this. But I actually don't like too much the sort of insurance policy argument of going to Mars. We want to go to Mars because something really bad might happen to everybody on Earth, all life on Earth, and somehow we need to put our eggs in that different basket. I mean, there's some merit to that argument, but I tend to want to go to Mars for a more positive reason. I think it's an exploration frontier. There are scientific marvels to be discovered in the cosmos. An alien form of life would be an amazing thing to discover. Think of what it could do to biology, to pharmacy. Let's not forget why humans, more pragmatically, what justifies the expenditure of going to Mars, okay? If you, again, look back at history, the biggest benefit that we got from going to the moon was not the increase in knowledge about moon rocks or the origin of the Earth-Moon system. That arguably was very exciting for people who study that or people who sort of learn from that. But the main benefit to us as a society was the fact that it bred an entire generation of people who went into science, technology, engineering, and math. I give a talk on going to Mars that shows this one plot. It's published by the National Science Foundation, and it shows the number of graduate degrees awarded in U.S. universities, master's and PhDs combined, in four scientific fields: computer sciences and math, earth and atmospheric sciences, engineering, and then physics. Okay, and all four curves go up as time goes by. That reflects the increase in population in the United States, so that's understandable. But there's a huge spike in all four fields right in the mid-60s, early 70s. And that was the Apollo program. It drew an incredible amount, a number of young people, young talent, into STEM fields. And this is why today we have the Jeff Bezoses and an entire generation of people who have created for the United States its cutting edge economy in sort of the in new technologies. So the biggest benefit of an exciting space program on our society is what it does to stimulating STEM education.
My wife has been encouraging me to apply for a one-way trip to Mars.
Is there a question?
Do you know any good divorce lawyers? We have a couple questions about terraforming, if you'd like to talk about terraforming. There's a long Kim Stanley Robinson Red Mars question, terraforming.
Terraforming.
Putting it out
there.
Well,
to terraform Mars, you need to send about, and I think it works out to be something like 10 to the 18th joules worth of energy to it, and that'll pretty much do it. If you can start melting the caps, that'll put CO2 in the air, and I don't know if you've heard this, but carbon dioxide causes a greenhouse effect. You may have heard that somewhere. And so what that means is that Mars would start to retain more energy than it emits from the sun, and so it would just get warmer and warmer, which would cause a runaway greenhouse effect on Mars, melt the poles, make a thicker atmosphere, which would then hopefully melt the water in the soil, and then from there, you could get to the point where you have an atmosphere of reasonable density and liquid water on the surface. Now that atmosphere is horrible. It's CO2. So it would take quite a ways before you could turn that into something you could step outside and breathe. But yeah, I mean, it's possible. It's scientifically possible, but I believe it's many centuries out. Nobody alive today will be around for that.
Yeah, you're right. I think I sort of like the science fiction vision of it, but it has to operate on timescales that are essentially irrelevant to terms in Congress. So we're talking about centuries of slow modification. You'd have to monopolize all the taxes of pretty much all of humanity for centuries on this single goal. It's like building a cathedral, but at the scale of a planet, and the cathedral is not here, it's on Mars, with the promise of one day creating on Mars I guess, another taxable society.
That's thinking that's long-term investing there.
So I don't think it's realistic.
Yeah, we have a me neither.
Two-part question. Number one, what type of fuel, i.e. chemical makeup, will be used on the first rocket in this program? Number two, what animals, if any, will be taken on the first trip?
Well, I'd like to talk about the rocketry. So the most efficient and also cheapest fuel to use for getting off Earth is just hydrogen and oxygen. First off, we have a lot of it. Second off, also Mars has a lot of it. And third off, it has the best specific impulse of any chemical reaction. And I'm not going to bore you with a prolonged physics lecture, but a specific impulse is basically a measure of how much oomph you get per kilogram of fuel. So hydrogen and oxygen is the best fuel to get there. Best fuel to get back is probably methane. Generated on Mars with the Sabatier reaction. Although if you can collect enough water and you have a large energy source like a reactor, then you can, you know, you can take the water apart into hydrogen and oxygen and then use that as your fuel back.
Yeah, that will work. I personally would like to advocate going nuclear for Mars, and here's why.
For that transit?
A nuclear thermal rocket, yeah.
Oh,
yeah, a
okay.
Nuclear thermal rocket was actually designed in the United States in the 60s, and it was canceled by, the whole program was about to fly, and it was just canceled by the Nixon administration. But the idea was to, you see, Andy just mentioned the specific impulse. With oxygen and hydrogen, you can only push a rocket at that specific impulse, okay, for something that's measured as 400 seconds, okay.
For reasons that we won't go into, specific
right.
impulses
but just
measured
to give you
in seconds,
a
just
sense
roll
of
with
the
it.
Efficiency that you get with a nuclear thermal rocket, it's 800 seconds, okay. So in other words, in a nuclear thermal rocket, you're not looking at a chemical reaction between oxygen and hydrogen. You're just taking the lightest gas possible, which is hydrogen, and all you do is run the hydrogen through a very hot reactor. You just heat it up. And that's a nuclear reactor. That's the best way to, that delivers a huge amount of energy in a very little space. It's very compact. So you run hydrogen through a nuclear reactor, and that will eject the hydrogen, which is the lightest gas possible. Therefore, the highest ejection velocities are achievable. You will eject hydrogen out the nozzle. And that is a super efficient way of going to Mars. You can get to Mars in 30 days. 30 days to 60 days, okay?
It's because you're constantly accelerating.
Now, I, you know, as much as I am wary of other uses of nuclear power, especially in weaponry on Earth, I think that good uses of nuclear power should really be not shied from, and space propulsion is the way to go. I mean, if you look at space, it's all the power out there is nuclear power, okay?
Fusion.
Do you think people will eventually live on Mars, and if so, when?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, so
Thursday.
I tend to see. I tend to envision Mars as being like Antarctica. We've been going to Antarctica for centuries. Okay, two centuries, and all we've deemed worth establishing there, in spite of some, you know, weird attempts by Chile and Argentina to actually set up a city there, which they've abandoned now, are research stations. So I actually envision that we will have, at some point this century, hopefully by the mid-2040s, an international research station on Mars, at the surface of Mars, led by NASA, hopefully, or by the United States, but something that would represent a collective effort by humanity to advance the scientific exploration of Mars. Now, that base could expand just like some Antarctic stations have expanded. McMurdo, for example, now in the summer has about 1,000 people in the summer occupying that station. So you have visiting scientists, grad students who go. You can imagine having, you know, that kind of opportunity on Mars someday. This notion of moving an entire population from the Earth or somehow growing a whole civilization on Mars, which is really a godforsaken place, and will remain so for a long time, I think that's really a romantic view of Mars and not not necessarily feasible. Yeah.
I agree. No one's going to colonize Mars until there's an economic reason to do so. And I mean, most of the arguments people use, freedom of expression or population pressure and stuff like that, it would be so much easier to colonize Antarctica or the ocean floor. And then once you've used those up, the moon. I mean,
yep. And what about a lava tube? Would it be possible to colonize a lava tube? And would it be possible to create a livable habitat out of a lava tube?
All the things he just said, again.
Yeah, so lava tubes, I don't know if you know, lava tubes are these tunnels that you find on the slopes of some large volcanoes. And they're really interesting because the way they form is lava is flowing at the surface of the volcano down its flanks, and then eventually the top surface of this lava flow cools off to the point where it becomes solid. So it stops flowing. But meanwhile, the lava that's trapped underneath still flows. And so all of a sudden you end up with this natural pipe that is circulating lava down the side of the volcano. And eventually the lava can run out, and then you end up with this hollow pipe that you can go explore and inhabit. So some people have proposed we should find a lava tube on Mars and colonize it. It's because it's a natural cavity, it's protected from radiation. I think that's an interesting idea for down the road. In the meantime, in the short term, I think, though, a lava tube would be really an exciting place to explore, because you'd be going inside Mars, away from the radiation environment at the surface, into terrain that might be warm and wet, if the volcano is still active, and some volcanoes on Mars are probably still active. So that would be like a prime real estate to go look for life. I think we will explore lava tubes and maybe down the road colonize them. Yeah.
This one you'll have to explain. This is an acronym here I'm not familiar with. What do you think about UAVs for exploring the surface of Mars? Is it feasible?
So UAVs are drones, the kind we use to blow people up. But presumably not that exact kind. So flying around on Mars is pretty difficult because it has an extremely thin atmosphere. So you could use rocket propulsion. But then you may as well just, my short answer, and we're running low on time, so I won't opine for too long. I don't think it's very feasible. You would need these gigantic propellers or this huge RPM, and I just don't think it's doable.
I agree. Good answer.
I think that's a good place to leave it. I think that's...
All right.
All right. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.